Hey guys, welcome back to the TI Qualifier Hub here on the Yasha stream. I'm Basekip.
I'm Waga.
And we've got another game coming up for you. We've got CDEC up against VGP, second game of this series. Draft's already underway, so I think we should pretty much just get straight into it.
I think so. Let's just hop in and see what the teams are doing. And the first game was very dominating performance. Mm-hmm. Can't say much other than that.
Very one-sided CDEC.
I mean, they got the start really of a lifetime, right? Going in and just getting a 14-0 perfect score was not a bad start. But now, as mentioned in the end of the game, like, you have to remember, only human. Don't go full crazy just because you took a perfect game.
Yeah, you don't get any of the gold or the experience or any of the in-game advantage. Yeah. A lot of it is just mental game.
See a little bit of respect here to the previous game from VGP and the ban. It's the only difference from the bans in the last game is that they banned out the Undying themselves and then picked the Shadow Fiend who was banned in the previous game.
Yeah.
So no Undying at least. And I think they're going to focus more on winning the laning stage because they never got to really play the game, right? They got shut down so early that you can't do anything. But that's Dota in this patch. You have to really not get punished on all lanes. Yeah. We said it after a game that they lost bottom lane, they lost mid lane, they lost top lane. If you do lose all three lanes, it's very difficult to win in this patch. Yeah. You don't have that kind of comeback mechanic.
And so, the draft message comes straight out. I just want to go back to the Undying for a second. So I know that after some of the tweaks that he received in the most recent sub patch, there was a little bit of discussion as to, is he still this first pick monster? Is he still worth grabbing that early in the draft? I think some people were saying that, okay, he's still good, but maybe not banned every single game kind of material, but CDEC, I think, showing a lot of the strengths of the hero in the last game. And they knew how to draft around it as well. They got it, and they just locked down the other two lanes with really strong one-on-one heroes, the Axe and the Viper.
They also managed to force the fights around the Undying. That was very key for them, because if you can't do that, then the Undying gets pretty useless. And a lot of teams are starting to understand how to play around Undying, and that's why you see him be less and less picked overall. Here, of course, in this series, being rated very high, but I think he had this kind of high impact in a competitive scene because people haven't really played against it in forever, and you underestimate how strong he is at dominating lanes. But let's give some respect over to Drought and Visage being given away here to CDEC, a combination that you will almost never see in, like, I've watched so many European games lately, and everyone pretty much bans out the Visage in the first phase if you don't have a second pick.
Yeah, heck, we're getting to the point where some teams, even after like Visage has been banned or it's been picked by the enemy team, they just take the Drow and take five ranged heroes
anyway. Sort of fine.
It still kind of works out. It definitely fits the laning theme that we're talking about a little bit this patch in terms of, okay, you're getting the precision aura to help out everybody, helps tip mid lane matchups one way or the other, especially the... I mean, I want you to weigh in on this, but it feels like the nature of mid lane at the moment has, as people are getting better, as the skill level improves, we start to see much more trading and solo kills are just not really a thing at all. So every little bit counts for so much on the mid lane these days, it seems like.
I mean, mid lane is mostly just about farming and what your supports are going to do and what the enemy supports are going to do. But I feel like it's been like that for a long time. I don't think it's changed that much, no matter the mechanics and things that it changed around. Mm-hmm. Like in last game, I don't think anyone would have died if it wasn't for early rotation by the Witch Doctor. And as soon as he does one little gank like that, the lane is like set. Viper's going to dominate very hard against the DK at that point. And it all really comes down to that single fact, one gank. But yeah, Drow Ranger damage is pretty good, especially if they want to have a range hero up against the Shadow Fiend on mid lane now. They can even put the Drow Ranger against the Shadow Fiend mid, it's doable, but I'm not a big fan of her ability to deny early game. And if SF gets good last hit first creep waves, then he can snowball out of control on that lane.
Yeah, so what else we got? Rubick, still just solid. We're going to be seeing him again. The one thing that interested me a lot in hearing it talked about at over the course of the summit was the Broodmother is the answer to this immediate Drow Visage. So we see it banned out here, but do you want to talk a little bit about, you know, why teams are so worried about the Brood when they're picking this 1-2 punch as the opener?
Yeah, well, pretty simple, really. Like, you don't have any AoE at all.
And so very little lockdown as well.
Yeah, if you don't have any stun and you don't have any AoE, yes, you have slows, but Birdmother doesn't care much about slows. She's so fast. It's just very hard to do much against her. And if you get an army of spiders on you, Visage third skill doesn't do anything for you. It's going to immediately be removed. And Drow Ranger, of course, she can't handle it. If you start getting run down, you'll easily die. So good ban by them. I'm not a big fan of the Rubick pickup that early here by VGP. I don't think picking Rubick into a Drow Visage first phase is... Well, I guess you can be super comfortable on the hero, but even then, I think you can grab a higher value pick there. Like, even the Broodmother would be okay, and then they can ban out the Axe in the second ban phase. Like, they have... Yeah. You know, they can set up a better game for the Brood than they had in the last case. Because Axe is really one of the toughest heroes to lane against as Brood.
Yeah.
I mean, I told her to farm jungle and so on, but it's... I mean, you're not meant to win that lane as Brood. Axe will win it pretty convincingly with his 3.8 base HP regen.
Yeah. The thing that I always feel with Rubick is that we have a lot of support players that are the drafters, and there are a lot of support players who love Rubick. So if we ever get into the situation where the support playing field is very level in terms of, okay, every support is viable, every support is pickable, they're all somewhat equally strong, though they all have their own niches.
Yeah.
I feel like we often just see Rubick because, one, he's decent in most situations, and two, lots of people just love to play him. Yeah. So I think that's
he's very rarely straight up bad. Like, right now, there are some skills that he can steal that are decent. You have the Ball Lightning, you can have the Witch Doctor spells are in general the best.
You should never get Death Ward, though.
Yeah.
Because you can toggle heal while you're channeling, so there is
unless if you're a good witch doctor,
if you're on zero mana, then that's a different story. But if you are playing witch doctor right against Rubick, I don't think you should ever be giving
it's similar to playing Doomringer, that you can always just blink in Doom and then Scorch Earth immediately, and you should not be giving away Doom. But you will still see it happen because people forget. Like, even pro players are only human. They will forget things, especially small things like this.
Yeah.
Here they have a good justification for the Rubick pick, though. Going into Lina himself, it's a very good hero to have the telekinesis alongside. And Clockwork is pretty good as well. Having the cogs for telekinesis is nice. But Shadow Fiend against the Storm with Drow Ranger damage is really not an easy lane.
Yeah.
That's going to be painful.
Do you think there's any incentive for CDEC to try go aggressive here? They've got the Visage, they've got a decent aggressive tri lane, and if they go for it, they can have somebody 1v1 the Clockwork, which isn't all that difficult. There's lots of heroes
they need to know deal with Clockwork hero.
1v1.
There's always some incentive to go aggressive tri-lane if you have...
And you keep the supports away from your Storm. I think that's the other factor.
Yeah. Well, if you have Visage and Witch Doctor, there's always incentive to go aggressive tri-lane because your supports are just superior at fighting compared to something like Rubick. But you have to watch out for what the last enemy...
That last pick's a bit scary.
Yeah, exactly. Because sometimes it's just more worth to keep down the Clockwork so he doesn't get level 6 early and, you know, pair him up against the tri lane so you keep Clock level so he doesn't kill your Drow Ranger repeatedly.
Yeah.
So that's the bigger issue.
Yeah. As much as Visage is the king of tri lane versus tri lane, he is definitely not the king of rotating or wanting to spend any time. So if you go for the aggressive tri lane and it goes badly, then... Yeah, he is a little bit greedy in general. But we see a Slark as the ban. CDEC can end up grabbing another ranged tier just to benefit as much from the aura as they possibly can as they end up going for the Nature's Prophet.
Yeah.
And VGP just getting rid of a Spirit Breaker as they go for a Lycan.
Lycan is sort of nice against Drow. You can rush in and just, you know, kind of chase him down. Along with Clockwork, Drow Ranger, what you're trying to do is just force the Drow Ranger to do, you know, to be running away all game long. But in these two drafts, I have to say that I favor CDEC again, though. I think they have really strong lanes, and their heroes, if they get a good early game, having something like Storm Spirit and Furion, you can go for pickoffs everywhere. And if you take over the map, Shadow Fiend won't really snowball that hard.
And they can Roshan minutes, not minutes into the game, but, you know, we could see if the lanes go as well this game as they did in the last game.
They can do it pretty quickly.
9 or 10 minute Roshan is no problem whatsoever. Pick up your medallion on the Visage, etc.
I think they won't necessarily need to stress that so much, though, because you just want to be having a long, steady laning stage when you're playing a Drow Ranger and, you know, five ranged heroes in general. If you can get a long laning stage, keep the clockwork low level, and just do that kind of game, you don't risk that much. If you go for Roshan early on, you're suddenly putting yourself where raises or clockwork or Lina, a lot of different things could punish you.
Yeah.
It's just a safer play, I think.
Yeah, it is at the very least nice to have Roshan potential of your own against the Lycan, because it means that it's not straight up guaranteed for him, and you can kind of take the pressure off yourselves a little bit by, okay, well, we can go and take it, and then we don't have to be worried about Lycan being off soloing it at some stage.
That's definitely a feeling.
That's a later kind of thing, I think.
Yeah, but that's definitely a true feeling to be able to do Roshan before Lycan. And we'll see the boots first here on Rubick in this game. Just try and have some vision here.
Okay, gets a little bit of scouting information, just seeing CDEC going for pretty much the exact same start out that they did in the previous game. They got four heroes running down towards bottom lane. This time around, it's going to be XZ on the Nature's Prophet making his way up towards top, and it looks like we could be seeing the aggressive tri lane potentially here. I think Nature's Prophet is, we touched on it a little bit in the last game, one of the biggest things when you're running an aggressive tri lane is sort of the assistance that can, or tri lane versus tri lane is the assistance that can come in a little bit later on. But as I'm saying this, Nature's Prophet's already rotating down bot, so it looks like not gonna end up happening. XZ is just gonna be in the off lane.
Yeah.
Super quick introductions. We've got the Bouncy Runes already picked up, going to the mid lanes at the moment. We've got XZ on your Nature's Prophet. We've got Cheeky on Storm, Q on Visage. We've got Garter handling the Witch Doctor and Aggressive on the Drow Ranger. Meanwhile, over on VGP, we've got Lycan in the off lane being played by Lin at the moment. James on Lina. Dogfight on Rubick.
So they want to try and go for the first blood return here. I mean, they did have a hard time last game. Let's see if the Storm can kind of smell this gank. They haven't seen anyone bottom. They only know Clockwork is there. He's definitely going to go down here unless something is messing up. No, he's dead. Good execution. They even get the last hit onto the Shadow Fiend. That's very big for him.
Yeah, so. And he's got the Necromancer level one. So.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. He gets full souls on that, actually. That's really, really sweet. Or not completely full. You get 12.
But definitely the kind of start that the Shadow Fiend's hoping for here in the laning phase. So should help tip things in his favor a little bit. VGP support still sticking around mid lane somewhat. They are being scouted out by this Dire Observer. So they shouldn't be overly successful here in the second rotation.
Yeah, they're kind of just running and trying once more. They want to try. But I think they should just leave the Storm versus Shadow Fiend now. Because if you get one kill here, the Shadow Fiend is really fine. They just need to try and focus on either winning bottom lane, because Clockwork right now is struggling against the Furion. Furion knows that there are no supports. Look at the CS. He's 5-4 against 1-0, and Clockwork is going really low on HP.
And now Garter and Q, no, they know where the supports are. They're rotating their way over. And the Rubick's being spotted. Dogfights, where are you going to go here?
Oh, this is going to be space creation.
He's got boots first, so...
He can run away.
He can run, actually.
Yeah, he's going to be fine.
Keep running. Okay, it looks like he's going to be sweet. Okay, so they didn't get the second gank, but they pulled the supports away from top lane, so... got at least a little bit of something there. 2 minute runes are about to pop up. XZ is going to be TPing down bot.
Oh, he gets the haste.
Oh, no. Okay, I think Rubick's still...
No, I think thinking maybe...
No, they've got the Lina here. Okay.
Yeah, they can maybe just walk out here. I was going to say, if he kept running up, they could cliff him, but he does have a ward as well, and kind of saw that Lina ran around the corner before. But, at least this is going to free up some time for Clockwork to farm, which is really nice, because he needed that badly. If they just left the bottom lane, it would be a disaster. So sacking the wolf and letting him just kind of leech here on top lane and do what he can is probably the better choice right now. I'm not a huge fan of offlane Lycan, should be said, but it is very important that you get levels on your Clockwork. So that's the trade-off that they're going for. They're switching, actually.
Yeah, here comes the switch up.
Hmm.
So Yang TP's to the offlane, but he doesn't have any regen.
It costs you quite much. Yeah, so. It costs you quite much doing these early TP rotations. And I don't know. Could have been better just starting offlane with the Clockwork. You have power cogs. You can just hold the creep wave. You will get under your tower. There's no denying that. But little switcheroo. At least they got the kill on mid, which was really good for them.
Yeah. I think they saw the four-man rotation down bottom from CDEC, and they scouted it with the Rubick, and they might have had the same reaction that I did, which was, oh, they're going aggressive again. So they tried to put the lanes in such a way that they had the Clockwork against the tri lane, but CDEC ended up playing it pretty nicely and just put standard lanes, which
could have been the case.
Yeah.
Good last hit here by Q, getting the Wild Wing in front of the Clockwork's face. Of course, he shares the experience, but the gold completely to Visage. And so far so good, I'm going to say. Storm is doing a fairly good job recovering, considering the fact that he died early on. He does have the Draw Ranger Aura, which helps you quite a bit on last hits, though, having 70 damage. But Shadow Fiend, going to check the top rune. No contesting on that one. They're stacking for Storm right now, so a little bit of a comeback mechanic being built up as well for CDEC.
Yeah, and you definitely need to get the Storm going, ideally. That's the one thing that CDEC's lineup is that's a little bit scary for them, I think, is that they are quite squishy on the whole. So if they get to the point where the Lycan is ahead and he's got farm and he just goes charging in, I don't feel like they have a ton of great answers for him. And yeah, as soon as the line breaks in terms of the team fight, then I feel like they're going to just lose two or three heroes every single time. So.
Yeah. See bottom lane here, if he can actually pull the creeps away a little bit. Because they're going for a tier 1 tower push here. They even have Illusion Rune on Rubick. But Furion doing the best he can. Just pulling creeps away and being a nuisance. Did a good job, actually. He got the full creep wave in a perfect position. Because now he can deny some of his creeps. He did get into the tier 2 tower range. If you get it perfectly there, you can deny a full creep wave from the enemy carry.
But doesn't even have to use the glyph in the end. So he's still got that up to be able to hold off another push. And VGP's looking like they're still keen to go for this. Lin's got his basket turned on, he's got his crawling blade in his inventory, and they're just kind of smacking creeps and pushing the wave.
Anytime you push this hard, though, the enemy offlaner is going to be getting a lot because you're giving him experience. You can't really deny and push. It doesn't work that way. So he's already closing up on level 5 on Furion. Clockwork, of course, is doing well, though. He's been getting almost 2 full levels since he switched to top lane. And did he go for... Yeah, he went for boots into Tranquil Boots. He's going to send out his ring very soon.
There's the ring of protection over on the courier. VGP support's looking a little bit lost, but looks like Dogfights is just going to go and get a little bit of stacking.
He can pull here if he wants.
Yeah, you can lift the creep up.
And not really necessary at this stage of the game and against the Furion, but you can do that.
Well, XZ looking for the 6-minute urn here. He needs to be a little bit careful. He's going to man down. As the Shadow Fiend turns up, can't afford to eat all 3 raises. But Dogfights is still looking for him. Can they get Vision in here for the lift?
Should be good. He's pretty fast. Shadow Fiend is slightly faster, but not fast enough to actually chase him down for kills.
Lucky that it was the regen rune.
Yeah.
If you're the Nature's Prophet there, if it's a haste that pops up. I think it was... Was it haste at 4
No,
minutes?
It was Illusion at 4.
That was Illusion.
So it was
2
minutes.
Okay, so he was running the risk of of a haste rune popping up and dying there. Yang, top lane, slowed up, drops down the cogs, but finds Garter in there with him. Soul Assumption comes out. It should just be a few more auto attacks. Can they get him in the trees?
They don't get
him. No.
Very nice.
Tranquil Boot armor actually helping out a lot there.
They didn't have the TP ready on Furion there. If they did, that would have been an easy kill. Because you can just TP behind as well, and there's no way out for the Clockwork. But very big for him there, he lives there. And bottom lane, aggression going in here.
And Lin gonna pop the ultimate, gonna pop a salve and just go charging in on XZ. Looks like it is actually gonna be VGP picking up that kill. Shiki, a little bit of mana
not
left
too
in the
much
tank.
Mana.
But gets the first crit.
Oh, he's dead here. He gets the magic one off. Yeah. He's gonna be fine then. This is a really good start for VGP. Coming in from last game, they already have, 2 kills. It's way better than last game.
Yeah.
They're going for the Vlad Rush on Lycan. No big surprises there. Going to be pushing bottom. They almost have mana boots now on Rubick as well, which is going to be pretty key for sustaining pushes. And Clockwork, he's still working on his level 6. That's so crucial that he gets it.
If you're VGP here, do you think when you rotate the Lycan into the jungle, do you farm the Lina or do you farm the Rubick? Do you want
you farm the Rubick until you have the mana boots, but then you want to have him off map, and Lina can just shove the creep wave with her spells later, because it's about efficiency, and Lina just farms so much faster. I think even if you want to blink dagger on Rubick really badly, you should be ganking. Oh, bottom, Shiki going aggressive alone against the Rubick here.
He doesn't get the ball damage, doesn't get
going?
The auto attack off, he gets lifted. Shiki, one last auto attack to finish it.
Oh, no,
gets it off. No stun from the Lina. TP threatened by the Nature's Prophet, but won't end up being necessary. Oh. That was a bit messy from both sides, I think. Top lane, jump in as well once again. Garter now in some trouble. Yang gonna eat some auto attacks. And the Treant's now soaking up the battery assault. So,
oh, wow.
Which bleeding, dies just fine.
Bleeding a few kills there. Stormer gets the solo kill on bottom, and then they die top, being really aggressive as well. He did get his level 6, though, so always something. Dying as offlane is not always that punishing. But giving away a solo kill to the Storm, even against multiple heroes, I don't know why the Lina decided to use Q instead of stun. Like, I don't know. Maybe he doesn't like James. Or James doesn't like dogfights. I don't know.
There's some rivalry going on there between the supports. Anyway, so TDEC gonna take that kill and start applying some pressure into this tier 1 tower. They've got the precision aura maxed out, so doing some pretty good damage there.
It's a very quick push, and no matter the Fade Bolt, they're still gaining this tower really quickly. Rubick is great at defending towers, and so is Clockwork, but that was just too much. The Fury and Treants help out so much. Tanking bottom. Nice little haste rune here, waiting for... I guess Visage just kind of snagged that.
Yeah, there's no other dire heroes even close, so it looks like he is
my time to shine.
what can I get done? Where can I do the most good?
Swiftly, to the farm. He's going to try and work on his level 6 here.
He's almost got it.
Yeah, and this is a good thing that they're doing. After they got level 6 on Storm, pretty much, or level 7 at least, they just switch up and move the Storm into jungle and try to be off map and ganking as much as possible. This is completely the right way to play Storm. You don't want to be steadily laning all the time. Top lane. Nice little attempt here. Is he going to go for the courier?
Xe pops out. He's got interests of
for the kills.
Yang instead. Ball comes in. Tried to TP out, but Cheeky's also there.
Yeah. That's a safer play. He could maybe have gone to courier, but good kill once again and going to help Cheeky keep snowballing. Bottom tower is being claimed, though, by Lin.
So it's not without its trades. VGP still getting things done there. Q, however, is also pushing mid, so yeah. Lots of action happening on the map right now. Shadow Fiend just going to be picking up a mech. Nothing too shocking there. Pretty much your stock standard build these days, actually.
Oh, yeah. I think there are two builds that you can really go for. It's either Yule Scepter into Blink BKB, or it's the mech into BKB into Butterfly, pretty much. Those are the two most standard builds, anyway. And the more popular in the Chinese and the Asian scene as a whole, it seems, is the mech BKB Butterfly. Honestly, my favorite as well. Unless it's a great game for Blink and Yules, and you know you can find multiple kills with it, then maybe you can go for it. If you have a good game and the enemy have some hero that you can unexpectedly kill, like a carry Slark or something like that, you can actually burst them with your ulti so easily.
Or a Storm or
yeah, exactly.
Like
but in a game like this, there's too much. There's the silence, there's the cast, there's the birds that could be there. And of course, there's the Storm himself. If you go on anyone else, Storm might just ball in and keep you down. So going for the Yule Scepter here would be much riskier. I like this build, though.
VGP... three-man smoke?
That's the Roshan attempt smoke, I think.
There's a train in the pit. I think they saw it going in there. So.
Yeah, so they're trying to find anything else, but Lycan is not really liking this.
There's a smoke from CDEC as well. Shiki's leading away. James going to get revealed. Lin as well. Shiki just goes balling in. Who's he going to go for? Looks towards Lin first. Death Ward gets dropped down as well. Cask bounces nicely.
Oh, God.
And that is going to open up the kill on the Lycan as the ultimate bounces through as well from the Nature's Prophet. He gets the Sprout off. Yang trying to make his escape. Lobs the hook towards his teammates, but doesn't land it, and that's going to be three totally unanswered kills.
Yeah, and they died right outside the doorstep of Roshan. That's like the worst thing that can happen against the Drow lineup, is dying right then and there. So, I mean, look at Roshan, how quickly he falls here as they just go in.
Yeah, they don't even have a medallion. Q is actually just going for a mech, seemingly. He's picked up a buckler here, but...
I suppose so.
There you go. Aegis over on the Storm Spirit.
And well, they didn't need the medallion at all, so that's fine, I think. And having the mech early against stuff like Clockwork and Shadow Fiend is going to help you a lot to just survive. I think it's a good build as well. But Storm getting Aegis this early on, that's terrifying.
He is like one of the best, if not the best, Aegis carriers pretty much in the entire game.
I think most people will agree that he's the best Aegis carrier. Yeah. I mean, unless you're talking about some carry that you really want to have Aegis on for high ground or whatever. Yeah. But in terms of what you can do when you respawn, you're back and you have everything. He's not cooldown dependent, and he uses the mana pool so well. Some heroes just come back for the second life, but they don't care much about the mana you get. So yeah. Let's see if they fight for this tower. They should, I feel. Storm is looking for it.
Storm up on the high ground. Cheeky getting in position. Looks like... Oh, there is some interest from the Nature's Prophet. He can always TP in. They're going to take
the
couple
though.
More seconds.
They see him rotating around here. They get the deny. Very nice. Very nice deny there by the Visage. So just got back off. They do know the rotation by Storm coming in.
Yeah, Shiki's just off scouting a little bit here, going to put some pressure on top lane, I think feeling relatively safe. The only thing that really kills him is lift into a light strike array.
Yeah, but I mean, stage, so. You barely, yeah, they could probably kill him twice if he gets completely caught out, so he can't play, you know.
You do have to be careful, light strikers are only a 7 second cooldown.
Exactly, it's so. Very low cooldown, but they kind of have to kill him without telekinesis the first time and then bring him down with it afterwards. So he can be fairly aggressive and create space for his team if they want to push bottom or top. Right now, CDEC playing pretty safe. They don't know where everyone is. So Furion is just being scouting with all his treants, trying to play some StarCraft here.
Yeah, cloning around the map, just keeping an eye on things. Lin's just farming up the jungle at the moment. And CDEC moving into a pretty aggressive position around this mid tower. Shiki falls down into the low ground and just eats a bunch of auto attacks.
He's looking for them, right? He's where are you guys?
Keen. He's definitely keen.
Whenever you have Aegis on Storm at this point in the game, you definitely want to go. So he's just trying to find anything. And he will find something nice. The DD rune on bottom, along with Aegis. Dear God, he is fit for fighting.
Yeah, they've got another 2.5 minutes on the Aegis here. So still quite a bit of time to go and get something done with that. And just kind of have to decide what exactly the target's going to be. Top lane, XE actually getting caught out here a little bit by Yang. Battery Assault only getting soaked up by the Nature's Prophet. And Lacuna Blade comes in to seal the deal. James going to pick that one up. All right, so VGP, the Aegis has been picked up. But since then, they've taken a tier 1. And they've, well, it got denied. And they found themselves a kill.
They will get a kill bottom,
as soon as
though.
I say that,
yeah, you cursed it. You cursed it. Caster Cursed is very real.
It is so real.
Oh, wait. He popped the DD rune when he was in the jump. That's a very sad mistake that can happen on Storm. If you pop the DD when you're jumping at Storm, you don't get it. You have to wait until you actually land. Before I started playing a lot of Storm games, I didn't know this, and I smashed my keyboard once for this. I'm like, why? Why is my damage not there? I think you can, however, pop the regen. I'm not 100% sure. I think you can pop the regen when you're in the jump, but not a DD or a haste.
I'll have to defer to you on this one.
We have Blitz on spot on site here somewhere, so we can just ask
once
him.
He's around, we'll make sure to confirm all the Storm mechanics. I'm sure he's
I'll
got.
I'll just pretend it's the truth for now, but I'm pretty sure it is. So he can confirm or deny. Jungle Storm OP.
Anyway, so CDEC gonna take that kill and pick up tier 1. Start looking towards this tier 2 as well, doing some pretty good damage. Precision Aura on cooldown for the time being, but they're still cleaning this up really quickly.
And they did change the familiars to not be semi-heroes in the same way, or the aura not to affect semi-heroes in the same way.
They're falling in. XLO, why did he walk up out of the high ground here? This is trouble. He's got the mech. Opens up a little bit of space, but there is a Sprout XZ. Really nice TP position coming
the
in there. And the cask bounces off the wolf and back on the dog fates, back onto the high ground.
That was a cask with a vengeance, dude. It really wants that Rubik. Well, Storm is trying to use his Aegis now. He could just as well respawn here. He has his full team behind him. And that kill on Shadow Fiend, that's massive. 27 seconds, still dead. I mean, he's not here in time. They simply cannot fight. They don't have hook. There's no way to stop this.
Cheeky falling in, gets the long range drag back onto Lin. Soul Assumption coming out. Cheeky does tank a Laguna Blade, taking quite a bit of damage here, but he wants to finish off dogfights. Is he going to be able to find him? The last couple of auto attacks do finish him off. James now sprouted in with the familiar Soul Assumption as well. Along with the Urn Charge, they bring him down, and VGP, still no Shadow Fiend. He's only going to pop up right as the Rax falls, and CDEC got exactly what they came for, and more. They just wanted the Tier 2, and it turned into a lane of Rax.
Yeah, and they're not even stopping. They want the range Rax as well. They're like, we know you're weak. Just give it up, and we'll back out.
Give them a few more kicks while they're down.
Yeah, but that's the second time the VGP kind of get caught on the same mistake. If you die close to an objective against a Drow pick, like,
this
you
is
lose
exactly
so much. That's the same as dying against a Tiny outside your base.
Or
like,
a Lone Druid.
You will lose your base.
Yeah, it's just gone.
Yeah. Like, first time they die outside the Roshan, now they die kind of unnecessarily after the Tier 2 tower is already down. I don't know why Shadow Fiend walked back in. He needs the BKB if they're going to fight.
And that last little sequence is going to shift it from a pretty close game around a 4K gold lead around I think it was about a 3K experience lead down to 7.5K experience and 12K net worth. The increased barracks gold is actually a pretty big factor there.
Especially if you get barracks this early. I mean, later on, yeah, you don't really care much. But if you get an 18-minute Rex, it's so much gold for your team now. So yeah, definitely it plays in. And not to mention they took the towers in succession as well. So really big for them. Let's see what VGP want to do here, because they're in a desperate pressed position. Bottom lane is going to push to even draw it on the map. Like, guys, this is pushing. What are we doing? They're just going to try and claim one tower. But against the Storm, this is ever so dangerous. If CDEC decide that, hey, we're going to fight you, they could just go. But I think CDEC are fine waiting for next Roshan right now. And just, you know, take mid tier 2 and don't force a fight until you get Roshan.
Yeah, just going to start coming in here. Nature's Prophet has gone for a blade mail into a Vlad, so XE just kind of picking up active items here, and I think CDEC are looking to close the door pretty quickly, maybe after that next Roshan gets picked up. Tier 1 for Tier 2 trade ends up going out. VGP smoking 3 heroes back, so looks like they might try and catch from behind or try and get something done. Shadowfiend with that tower going down does have his BKB now, so he's a little bit more fight ready. The hookshot flies in. Who are they going to catch? It's actually 2! Cogs coming in as well. Good chain stun coming out. Requiem of Souls as well. XLL opening up with the right clicks and the raises. Aggressive just getting right click down somewhat. It's only the Witch Doctor to fall so far. It's a 2-for-2. Lin chasing through with the ultimate. Still has a little bit of duration left. XZ, Blade Mail cooling down. We'll be able to pop it once again, but Lin gets dragged back by the Vortex.
Yeah.
And it still ends up being a good fight for CDEC. That net worth advantage.
And
really
Shadowfiend doesn't
through.
Even kill, get to kill on Visage. No, he turns. He gets greedy. Gotta try once more. I think he's dead because of that. Lina has to buy back here. I don't think it matters. SF is still dead. And that's just so many Bloodstone charges. Oh, she might get the return kill here, but Wolves gonna have to do some work for that.
Q.
He can get the Visage with the Wolves.
I think he's...
Oh,
is he? He's, got
he's
a
pretty tanky.
He's still got these charges.
He's losing the charges now. They're gonna start dealing a lot of damage next to auto attack.
He could just smoke, couldn't he?
Yeah, if he wants to. If he really wants to live. He's fine. He knew all along. He's good.
Yeah, there you go. Garter's here. Gives him an urn. Gives him a bit of a heal. Dogfight's going to steal the ball lightning and go zipping in.
Oh,
gets
that
the lift, but they don't quite manage to get off the light strike array. And poor James is going to go down. Nope. Not quite yet for the second time. Survives on like 5 HP, but four-stabbed into an urn. Garter picks up the kill. Yang's not done. The fight continues. Garter now trapped in the cogs, but aggressive has returned. Yang's going to try and TP out here.
He gets punished pretty hard. Oh, and Rubick going to be fine for now as he has the ball lightning, gets out. But
this
that was pretty much the
up.
Perfect initiation for VGP. They got a hook onto 2, and the third one jumped in as well. The Storm joined the inside the cog. Lina comes in and Shadowfiend comes in at the same time, dealing so much damage. But I don't know. They're just so far behind in items that even with perfect initiation, it's so hard to win that fight.
I feel like it was a really smart play to go forward with the early smoke back and trying to find that perfect angle into the fight, but unfortunately just the situation that they're in after how bottom lane went ends up really costing them. So CDEC just going to march up out of the high ground, do a little bit of damage here to the ranged racks.
I mean, they could just wait for Roshan right
now.
If they want to play,
like 20 seconds.
Yeah, if they want to play fully disciplined, they could back out, but I think they're strong enough to force as well. It's up to CDEC. But I think if they just back off, there's no real way that VGP can turn this game. So the 100% like safe route should be backing. And let's see if that's... It doesn't even that's what they're going to do.
They've got a lot of unspent gold as well. So that's new items coming up with only a couple of minutes of farm. So
yeah,
I
you
think
can have the BKB on Drow very soon. That's the biggest thing, yeah.
Yeah, I think you definitely just back up, farm a little bit more, maybe finish another item on each of your cores, grab the Roshan, and then just pretty much go end the game. I mean, they've got a pipe... Now over on the Visage as well, so it's just so tough if you're VGP. And they know, they realize that if they give away this Roshan,
I mean, VGP
then
no
the game
smoke.
Is just over.
They have to walk there and kind of stand around, but then bottom lane is going to shove, and CDEC are in no rush. They can even send a Fury and split push if they want.
Or the Familiars,
exactly.
Or they can pop Precision Aura.
Like, mid is exposed. Yeah, they can just go and take the Ranged Rags mid, and if they go to defend, they take the Roshan. So this is a terrible spot to be in as VGP, and... Yeah, they're kind of just facing reality now that they have to go back, but if they do, I mean, how are they going to defend against Aegis? It's not happening, so this is a tough spot. They do have good vision here, though. Good vision on with the Wolves trying to scout around, but yeah, we see a smoke actually from CDEC.
Yeah. They see pretty much everything on the map right now. They have some really good wards going out. And just going to start running straight over towards mid lane. They're pinging over on the Lycan. A bunch more pings going out bottom lane as well. CDEC going to shift course. Cheeky leading the way. He's got 14 Bloodstone charges, so pretty quick respawn for him if he does end up going down. Really aggressive zip. Mech gets popped super early by XLL, and he's still just going to be focused down here. Can he get off the BKB? He is able to do so, but the Death Ward is going to finish him off. Garter getting stunned up with Q, trapped inside the cogs. Goonblade comes in, but they're both still alive here. XE just tanking through everything.
Look at him, and the Furion. He doesn't go down.
He just stands and hits. Oh my god.
That's game. There's actually no recovery from that. They tried one last time, but Furion immediately being healed up for full. He can even go base and TP back again. They're going to try one last attempt here. Yeah. Because why not? But I don't think there's anything you can do. 18 charges on the Storm now on his Bloodstone.
Rex is going to end up falling. And for CDEC, I mean, like you said, the super disciplined play is to just back up and take Roche and
in general,
make sure 100% that this game is yours.
In general, there's something that, you know, throughout the times of Dota, I would say China really excels at is the discipline of just not taking unnecessary risks. When you're at this position, you're not meant to lose ever as CDEC. If you lose this, it's completely on you. You can say the enemy played correctly or whatever, doesn't matter. You need to have made several big mistakes. In this patch, there's no massive comeback mechanic.
And VGP, they do have a smoke now. They're just charging straight over towards the pit.
Yeah, they
Centaur
do have the smoke.
Blocking
try.
Things a little bit here, making the hook actually a bit difficult for the clockwork.
Good angle, though. Micro. He can go for this. He can steal it.
Oh, comes hooking in. Is he going to be able to grab it? No, the Storm Spirit gets his hands on it. Now Yang and Dogfight's
so
isolated inside the pit. They're both going to be brought down. James a little bit further out. XLL does pop his BKB a little bit earlier this time around, but the right click still laying into him. Lin goes chasing off to the side, looking for Garter, but the rest of his team is already dead.
Yeah.
And he's just going to be forced to TP out. And that is going to end up being the GG called by VGP. So CDEC going to end up taking this opening series for them 2-0. And
yeah, very strong.
The best start that they could hope for.
Yeah, here. This game looked like it could maybe turn into, you know, somewhat of a VGP favorite start, but they quickly turned that around again. I mean, they got 2 kills straight off the bat. They had fairly good there, but I think the TP rotations cost him a lot, so CDEC getting the lanes a little bit better, and then just solo kills happening. Getting kills with Storm like that is massive. They managed to secure a lot of momentum for him, and he just kept going. I think Storm just played really well. Shiki, good performance by him.
Yeah, I definitely agree. I mean, I think the other thing that stood out to me really from the Storm Spirit play is that we see some Storm players take a more farming-oriented approach to the hero. Their supports will set up stacks for them. They won't really get involved until their Bloodstone is up. And I mean, maybe they'll hold on to a TP scroll and counter gank. But Cheeky, he handed the mid lane over to Q, let him get the farm for 6, let him get some farm towards the mech.
Yeah.
And he went around and ganked, and he went around and made things happen.
I think Blitz would be very happy to see Cheeky playing in this game, because he just did what you would expect from a Storm. Like, you get your levels on mid lane, then you go off the map and you will gank. So the enemy doesn't really know where or when you will strike. And this game, I mean, it's more even than the previous game, but still a very dominating show from CDEC, taking the game really convincingly.
Yeah, I mean, they seemed like they had a plan with both of the drafts as well. It feels like they came in and they're like, well, okay, they didn't give us this hero, but they gave us this one. So this is the line of play that we're aiming for.
They kind of gave them the Visage Drow, though. I don't know if you should ever do that in this current patch. Yes, it's a little bit nerfed, but it's still just terrifying to go up against. I'm not sure if you should give that away. But it comes down to respect bans as well.
Yeah.
Like, they had to ban out the Undying they felt in this game after the previous one. And then you leave Visage. They didn't really care for the Visage in the first game either. So, I don't know. It just comes down to preference. There are so many strong heroes, so it's tough to say which one you should go for. But here we see Shiki, man of the match, I would say, did really good, considering the fact that he died as well. Like, he died on level 1, and got smoke ganked, but he did a really strong recovery and did not die a single time after that. So
yeah, and like we were saying, he wasn't really propped up by the supports either.
They gave him like one stack.
They gave him like one stack, but he kind of dragged himself back into the game and made things happen. And
that's what I want to see as well. Like 77 last hits. You don't need high last hits on Storm to have a good game. You just need to be at the right place at the right time. So that's the most important part.
Yeah, I think he did a really good job as well, because he's kind of the primary initiator for the team as well. And that can be a little bit scary on a hero like Storm Spirit, especially if you don't have a
against
BKB.
Rubick.
Yeah, your positioning needs to be really immaculate in where you choose to land and then throughout the vortex. And I feel like every single time, target selection was really good and didn't get ahead of himself, always made sure that his team was there to back him up and ready.
He did a good job, but I also think that VGP had some sloppy mistakes. Like when they went on Rubick on bottom and Lina was there to stop the storm, I thought that was going to be him dying early on and really losing a lot of momentum. But instead, Lina decides to not use her stun. Like, try at least to save your teammates. Because yes, Storm could maybe dodge it, but he had no mana. He was flat out of mana at that point. So if she went for a stun, he could actually have saved a teammate and turned around a massive scenario there.
Yeah.
So like small misplays like that can really impact your game very heavily.
So as much as it was kind of one-sided, we are talking about CDEC being one of the favorites to top two out of the entire qualifier. So how do you feel that this showing, how do you feel about VGP as a team after this match? I mean, you probably haven't seen a whole lot of them.
I haven't watched them that much. And so honestly, I think that E-Home is even stronger than CDEC as well.
Yeah,
so
I think everybody
like
agrees
a lot
with
stronger.
That.
CDEC is like okay, but if we compare it to some of the other teams, I don't know. I think VGP have a lot to prove still.
Yeah.
This was definitely a terrible series, but any team can have a really bad series. So we'll see as the days continue, I guess.
Yeah, so that's going to wrap it up for our series here, guys. Our next match is...
We'll have more games. Well, Old Boys against Energy Pacemaker Gaming.
Yeah, that should actually be...
I think that should be a good series.
Yeah, that should be one of the... Probably one of the better matches to watch out for. So.
I think so. Other games that we'll have today is like TF against Wings.
Is that Old Boys' first match as well? Did they play first round?
No,
so
yeah.
That's the one thing people are talking about. We need to kind of see what form Old Boys are on. They've got the star power, but they don't have any real matches to their name.
They definitely have the star power. There's no one doubting that. I mean, those are some famous names. These players, a lot of people who don't actively follow the Asian scene are not really going to know who they are. But no matter, if you follow Dota, you will know who Old Boys are.
You know who's on Old Boys.
Yeah.
So, guys, that's going to wrap it up here. For CDEC versus VGP, we're going to throw it over to a break. And when we return, it's going to be Old Boys versus Energy Pacemaker. Thanks a lot for tuning in here to the TI Qualifier Hub.
See you guys
over
soon.
On the Asha stream.